Great song, great picture of that. Thank you, Kavon. Great expression of that this morning. You know, these past several weeks, we've been talking about the fact that we are warriors. In the army of God, we've been called forth to stand as soldiers of the cross. And last week, we kind of took a little bit of a side route in that, and we talked about the fact that Jesus is the mighty warrior, right? He is the mighty warrior. And we talked about the fact that Jesus Christ is the mighty warrior and won the battle from darkness, when darkness seemed like it was winning. What do you do when darkness is rising? And the thing that we're reminded of is that Jesus Christ did not step away from the cross, but he stepped into the cross. He didn't run from the suffering, but he came to the suffering and took it upon himself. He stepped into the cross, not away from it. He stepped into surrender, into selflessness, and to obedience, and he overcame. He won the battle. And so because of that, we are not discouraged, and we are instead encouraged. We lift up our head and we recognize that the battle has been won. The battle for our souls, the battle for who we are, has been won in Jesus Christ. And we realize that with that we are called to follow our leader. Jesus said, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And so it is not simply his cross now, but it is our cross. We have been bought with a price. We are no longer our own. And so we have, if we are going to come to Jesus by faith, we are coming to him to take up our cross and do just as he did and step into the cross, not away from the cross. Now, this morning I want us to think about this. What do we do when death roars? When darkness rises, Jesus Christ won the victory. And when death roars, Jesus Christ wins the battle. That's what Easter is all about, folks. That Jesus Christ has won when death roars. You know, how loud is a lion? You know, you think about roaring, something roaring, you have to think about a lion, right? How loud is a lion? I remember a few years ago when we took a trip to Zimbabwe, a mission trip, we took a little side trip to this little refuge where they had some young lions, and there was one pen where they had a group of male lions. And I mean, I love this stuff because I'm one of those people, if I'm going to watch the Discovery Channel or something like that, I'm going to watch about the big cats, you know, the big cats. And give me the lions and the tigers, not either, you know. And here we are, there's a fence, and then just a few feet away, like where the first row is, there are these young male lions in there. Most of them already had their manes. And they, as a part of the exhibition, they threw this hindquarter of a cow in there. And I'm telling you what, I, if you'll forgive me for saying it this way, all hell broke loose. I mean, this was the roaring lion, roaming to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. And that cow hind part, you know, was done. But what was amazing was the violence of it. I mean, we're just a few feet away, and it was everything you could do to keep from running. But not only the violence, but the sound, the noise. These lions are going at each other, and each one of them getting their piece of meat, right? And the biggest one, of course, comes away with the larger piece, and the others kind of follow him, and he drops it, turns around. Whoa! I mean, just earth-shattering. And they all just kind of go back and get the little crumbs, you know. They're good with that because the lion roars. You know, they say that if you're out in the bush in Africa and you hear a lion roar, that you can sometimes hear them. I don't know if this seems far-fetched, but they say you can sometimes hear them from 5 miles away. That the lion roar has been measured at 114 decibels. The average rock concert is 100 decibels. Now imagine that, and you're standing right there, and they say that it's 25 times louder than a gas-powered lawnmower. And with all of that, I mean, the lion roars, and how loud is the roar of a lion, but how loud is the roar of death? And you look all around us, and you see, right? And you hear about it, you see it, you experience it. We do everything in the world to cover it up. We do everything in the world to kind of tone it down a little bit. I mean, you go to a funeral and the person in the casket looks like they're getting ready to go to the prom or maybe to a party, right? And they look anything but dead. And not only that, but you know, we kind of hurry through and we don't open up the casket many times because we just kind of want to cover it all up. But the fact is, when death roars, you can't cover it up. It will pierce your mind and it will shatter your heart. And it will change everything about your existence. What do we do when death roars? The followers of Jesus Christ heard something in Jesus they never thought they would hear. They heard death roar. They thought that the one who healed others would himself never be wounded. They thought that the one who raised others from the dead would himself never taste death. They thought that they would be putting him on a throne. But here we find them laying him in a tomb. In John chapter 19, verse 30, we read simply this: Jesus said from the cross, "It is finished," and he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. So verse 40 says they did the only thing they could do. They took the body of Jesus and they bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. And now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb, in which no one had been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. Death roared. They walked away in silence, no doubt that day. They didn't know what to say. But death was piercing their minds and shattering their hearts, and no doubt they could hear the roar of death. Have you ever been there? Have you ever walked there? You know that death has a tremendous roar. But I want you to know too that that was Friday, and Sunday was coming. And so we read, now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to him, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and this other disciple is John, best we understand. At other places he calls himself the disciple whom Jesus loved, and I don't think he was bragging when he said that. I think he was saying that in amazement. The disciple whom Jesus loved, they ran and it says she goes to him, they've taken the Lord. So Peter went with the other disciple and they were going toward the tomb. And both of them were running together. But John just throws this in, right? The other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. I mean, you know, you got to give John a little man stuff here. You know, I outran Peter. Peter thought he was fast, but I got there before Peter. And he stoops and he looks in and he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there and the face cloth which had been on Jesus' head, and noticed the attention to detail, the face cloth not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. And then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first went in and saw and believed. For it says, as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. And what we understand, what we realize here is that though Jesus had at times told them he was going to die and that he was going to rise again, for some reason they just couldn't quite get it. They couldn't quite understand it. We don't exactly know why they didn't understand. Maybe it was that their minds were just shadowed by God, and in some way, God just kind of covered up their eyes and covered up their ears so they couldn't get it. They couldn't quite grasp it. And maybe there's somebody here today, you've heard these things before, but for whatever reason, you've never quite grasped what's going on here. You've never fully understood what's going on here. And I pray that today would be the day that you would not just simply know some facts or know some kind of wistful story about a man dead and rising from the grave, but that you would truly know and understand what this is all about. Luke 18, and in the booth, we're going to fast forward here just a little bit down to verse 32 in Luke 8:2. It says, "For he will be delivered over to the Gentiles and will be mocked and shamefully treated and spit upon. And after flogging him, they will kill him. And on the third day, he will rise." But they understood none of these things. This saying was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said. But they're about to get it. They're about to get it in an amazing way. John saw, and it says in some way he believed. And then verse 10, back in John chapter 20, then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Still yet, Mary does not understand. And I wonder this morning, do you understand? I mean, do you really understand what's going on here? Do you understand the implications of this for your life? Do you understand how this changes everything? Do you recognize what is going on and how this can turn your life upside down? Do you understand that Jesus Christ died, crucified on a cross, that they buried him on Friday, and that on Sunday he rose again, and that for those who put their faith in him and come to him in a response of faith, your life will never, ever be the same? Many of you have heard death's roar recently. Some of you, maybe if I asked, how many of you have had a loved one, close loved one, die in the past year? Many of you would lift your hands. How many of you? The past year, you've had a loved one who's passed away. A father, a mother, a brother, a sister, maybe a child. You've seen pass away. When death roars, it's deafening. Pierces your mind, it shatters your heart. If you don't understand what's happening, it will overwhelm you. It will absolutely overwhelm you. What do you do when death roars? And I'm just going to give you one thing to do, and then I'm going to tell you a whole lot of truths that come up out of that, and that's this. Do this. Let your life be swept up this morning in the victory that accompanies the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Let your life be caught up in this fact that Jesus Christ was dead, buried, and risen from the grave and is alive forevermore. Let your life be swept up in this morning. Mary is swept up in this. She, at first, verse 14 in John 20, having said this, she turned around and she saw Jesus standing, but she did not know it was Jesus. And we wonder, why didn't she know? I mean, she was very much acquainted with him. Maybe some say it was because it was still dark. Maybe it was because her eyes were clouded with tears. Maybe, again, it was just that the Lord had not revealed it to her yet. Maybe Jesus in his resurrection body was somewhat different from what he was like before. Maybe it was just more than she could hope, more than she could ever expect to take place. And Jesus speaks to her again, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for? Whom are you seeking?" And supposing him to be the gardener at this point, I mean, everybody but Jesus is what's going through her mind. Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And then Jesus does something that opens her eyes. He simply speaks her name. He speaks her name. You know, it is my prayer this morning that for somebody in this room, you may know the facts that we're talking about here today. Maybe they're kind of far-fetched to you, but you know about them. But it is my prayer this morning that your eyes will be opened, that you will hear Jesus Christ speak your name this morning. Not audibly, of course, in your mind, down deep inside of your soul, that you will hear Him speak. When I was just a boy, I heard Jesus Christ speak my name. Kenny, come to me. And God, and I did what He requires of us. And I can't take any credit for this. I can't take any credit for this. I was a dead man at the bottom of a lake, and no light left in me, and nobody could rescue me. He had to come, and He had to lift me up out of that. I was dead in trespasses and sins, but He has made me alive by God's mercy. I am alive today. He spoke my name, and in speaking my name, my eyes were opened to Him, and I came to realize what Mary comes to realize here. Jesus said to her, "Mary," and she turned around, and now she sees, and she speaks in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me." And I think it must be because Mary just fell down at His feet. I mean, this is what Mary seemed to do. You know, see, she just fell at His feet, and she probably just takes hold of Him, and she's just stricken by what's happened here. "Do not cling to me," He said, "for I have not ascended to the Father, but go to," and what does He say? "Go to my brothers." And this is a showstopper, folks, because I want you to understand that never before has Jesus called them brothers. He's called them disciples. He's called them even friends, but He's never called them brothers. What's changed? Why would He now call them brothers? It is because the transaction has taken place that God had intended. It is because God took the sin of every person who would come to Him by faith. God took our sin, and He put our sin upon Jesus Christ, and He took the righteousness of Jesus Christ, and He put it upon us. And so now the believer's relationship with God is forever changed. And so we read in John 1, "As many as received Him, to them He gave the right to become children of God." The relationship is changed. God, He is no longer God at a distance. He is no longer the man upstairs. Please. He is the one who has come to you and has taken your sin upon Himself. And taking your sin upon Himself, He went to the cross and He tasted the wrath of God for you and for me. He gave Himself for us, and He gave us what only He could give, the right to be called children of God. And so, guess what you're called now? You are sons and daughters of God. When you respond in faith to Jesus Christ, you're not even just a friend of God. You are brought up under the same family. And you are given the right to become a child of God. In Hebrews chapter 2, the writer of Hebrews speaks this way: "Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God He might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting that He, for whom and by whom all things exist," I mean, the one who created it all, the one who sustains it all, "it is fitting that in bringing many sons to glory," He's talking about every person who would come by faith, "many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For He who sanctifies," that means He who makes holy, He who makes righteous, "and those who are made righteous, made holy, all have one source. That is why He is not ashamed to call Kenny Armstrong His brother." How about it? How about it? I mean, think about it. Come on. Think about it. You are no longer out there somewhere. But you have been brought up into the same family, and He puts His arm around you, and He brings you unto Himself. "My brother,
message today. When death roared, Jesus Christ took death and used death to change our relationship with God forevermore. And so then, and so we read it, and Jesus said, and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father, to my God and to your God. And what I want you to see here is that Jesus Christ, who calls us his brothers and sisters today, that Jesus Christ is victorious right now. Right now. He was not just victorious then and will be victorious later when he comes again. He is victorious right now. In this moment in time, Jesus Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Ephesians chapter 1 says that he who worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. Jesus Christ is victorious right now. He is our mighty warrior. He has overcome darkness and he has overcome death. When death roared, he stepped into death. He stepped into death and defeated death. And so not only was he victorious then, and not only will he be victorious off there in the future somewhere, but he is victorious right now. That means the one who walks with you day in and day out is with you when you're tempted. That means the one who died for you is with you when death roars. That means the one who died for you is with you moment by moment, day by day in the challenges of life. That every challenge, he stands there rising up to meet that challenge so that you might have the victory right now as well. Do you see that? Jesus Christ is victorious now. That's why I want to walk with him. You want to pick a winner? Well, let me introduce you to one. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ, victorious right now. And verse 18 in John 20 says, Mary Magdalene, after she heard this, she went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord, and that he had said these things to her. And what I want you to see in this is that in rising, Jesus Christ has defeated death. Death is defeated. And so that we have this victory even over death. When death roared, Jesus Christ defeated death. He is our mighty warrior. In 1 Corinthians 15, the Apostle Paul, trying to help us to grasp this and understand this, and if you want to read something that's both absolutely amazing in its simplicity and absolutely astounding in its profundity, read 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and listen to what Paul says. And if Christ had not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. You are still under the darkness of sin. And then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. Death roared and death won if Christ had not been raised. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. That means he is the first of many. That means the first of many. This is a promise of what is to come. For as by a man came death, that's talking about Adam, if by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. As in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. This is the ultimate question, isn't it? The ultimate question, number one, has anybody ever cheated death? I mean, when death roars, something you want to know is this. Has anybody ever won over death? Has anybody ever cheated death? And the second part of that question is this. Have they left the way open for me? And the answer is yes, somebody cheated death. His name was Jesus. He is the mighty warrior who overcame death. But he didn't just overcome death, but he made a pathway through death, so that we might stand in the presence of God for all eternity. When death roared, Jesus Christ defeated death. And number four, death has no hold. That means death has no hold on those who believe. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. And whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. What is he talking about there? He's simply saying, listen, yes, that person stops breathing. But what happens when that person stops breathing? The one who's come to God through faith stops breathing on this side and starts breathing on the other side. It is as if that person never dies. That person just passes right from this life into the life to come. And death has no hold on me today. Not because of anything I've done, but because Jesus Christ, the mighty warrior, defeated death. And then he asks the question, do you believe this? Coming right back to this, that God requires a faith response. It is not enough just to know about this. It is required of us that we respond in faith. Do you believe this? Are you willing to stake your life on it and put your hand in his hand this morning? And the fifth thing we see is because of this, Satan is defeated. Last week we saw that Satan is defeated, that Jesus Christ, when darkness rose up, Jesus Christ stepped into the darkness and he overwhelmed the darkness. He overcame the darkness. This week we see that Jesus Christ not only overwhelmed the darkness, but he overwhelmed the grave. He overcame death. And so we read Hebrews 2 verse 14, since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things. This is just talking about Jesus took on flesh and came as a man, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil. Last week we talked about the fact that one of the ways that Satan gets hold of us, one of the handles Satan has on us, is our sin. Because of our sin, it is as if we step into the courtroom of all eternity. And as we step into the courtroom, there is one there to accuse us. He is called the accuser. That's what the devil means, the accuser. And he stands there and he says, this one has rebelled against you, God of the ages. This one has turned his back on you. This one has disobeyed and sinned and broken your law. But for the one who's put their trust in Jesus Christ, up steps another one, our advocate, Jesus Christ. Our mighty warrior is a mighty warrior in the courtroom too. And he steps forward and he says, but this one is mine because I took this one's sins upon myself. And I gave my righteousness to this one. And therefore, this one cannot stand under accusation anymore. And the accuser of the brethren, as he is called, loses his grip. And not only has he lost his grip because of sin, but he has lost his grip because of death. You see, the end result of sin is death. God told Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, if you eat of the tree, you will die. Simply this, you'll die. And all down through the ages, this truth has hung over the heads of every person who's ever taken a breath, that one day you'll die. But what I want you to see is that in rising from the grave, Jesus Christ not only loosed the grip of Satan because of sin, but he loosed the grip of Satan because of death. Death no longer has hold over us. And death is transformed for us from something that is a piece of the darkness and belongs to the darkness, something that is hopeless and something that is absolutely overwhelms us. Death has been changed. The roar of death has been quieted because Satan has been defeated. The one who holds the power of death, that is the devil, has been destroyed. Hallelujah. And so Satan is defeated. That's part of this victory that you're swept up in when you come to God through Jesus Christ. And not only that, but we see And number six, the fear of death. The fear of death has no hold on those who believe. Why do they call it terrorism? Ultimately, they call it terrorism because of the fear of death, right? If we weren't afraid to die, there would be no terror. But it doesn't take a terrorist with a bomb to bring this fear out. Hebrews chapter 2 says, and he delivers those, all those who through the fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. Death enslaves every person. And again, we do everything in the world to try to cover it up or to make it seem not so daunting. And yet, death pierces our minds and shatters our hearts. And the roar of death, it just absolutely consumes us. But for the believer in Jesus Christ, death has been defeated. Death has no hold on us. We dread the suffering? Yes. We dread the separation? Yes. But we embrace the end result. Because we know that death is the doorway through which we pass into the presence of the one who gave himself for us, who loved us with an everlasting love. The Apostle Paul, just acknowledging this, said, "For me to live is Christ. This is who I am. I put my faith in Him. There's nothing more, nothing less about my life than this. For me to live is Christ, and to die is what?
Gain.
Gain. And then he says, I'm torn between the two. I want to stay here and be with you. And he's writing to the church at Philippi. I want to stay here and be with you and minister with you and spend time with you. But my desire, here's my desire, he said, is to depart and be with Christ. For that is what? Far better. Far better. You know, it's kind of cliche, right? I mean, at a funeral, you go through and you say, you know, I'm so sorry that your dad passed away, your mom passed away. You know, and we kind of buck up in that and we say, but they're in a better place, right? That's true. It's not. It's a cliche because it's true. It's so true that my mother today is in a better place. Not just better, but far better. How can you measure it? And yes, we dread the suffering. And yes, we dread the separation. But we embrace the end result because Jesus, the dead Lord and Jesus Christ overcame the grave, the death, and overwhelmed the grave. Now, John chapter 20 goes on and said, verse 19. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." Now I want you to notice what's happening here. These guys are scared to death. They locked the doors. The same people that killed Jesus, that's what it's talking about, for fear of the Jews, they're afraid they're going to come and get them and kill them. And so they lock the door. They're scared to death. Isn't it amazing that when you get over into Acts chapter 4, and these same Jews that it speaks of here are standing in front of them, threatening them, telling them, if you speak the name of Jesus anymore, we will put you to death too. And they rise up and say, what are we to say? Are we to obey God or are we to obey men? They face death right square in the eye. Why? Because of what they're going to see right here and what they're going to experience right here. Jesus comes and he stands among them and he said to them, "Peace be with you." It is the word shalom. Be still. Be at ease. Let the peace of God overwhelm you. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. What's he doing? The scars, the nail scars. Look, I told you that death could not hold me. Look here. Here are the scars. Look here. This is where they ran the spear through my side. Death could not hold me. I am alive. I'm with you. Peace be with you, he says again. And it says simply this, that the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. That's got to be the understatement of understatements. And can you imagine the death has roared and you're hunkered down, scared to death that it's going to come and get you. And there the one who overwhelmed death stands among you. And he says, peace be with you. And they were glad. You better bet they were glad. You better believe they were glad. And that gladness comes all the way down to you and to me, because right here among us is the Lord, the risen Lord. We cannot see him, but he said, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. We know by faith that Jesus Christ is with us. And so Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. And then he says this, as the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. And what does he do? He's commissioning them, and he's commissioning us. He's saying, if this, you believe this, you got to tell somebody. I mean, does it make any sense that we would say we believe this and that we would do that? I think it is the most asinine thing in the world that we as believers in Jesus Christ think somehow we're supposed to get over in a corner and keep to ourselves and meet behind our walls and not go with the good news that Jesus Christ has overcome death. We have good news to tell, and we are obligated to tell it. When we were in Mali, in the little village of Sandama, we were speaking to one of the chiefs there, and the chief, who's a Muslim, was standing there, or was seeing what was happening with many young men becoming believers in Jesus Christ. And here's what he said to Jim Snyder, our director of missions, and I. He said, those who know what you know and have heard what you have heard ought to come and tell people you've never heard. Here's a Muslim chief of a village giving us the Great Commission. Folks, your neighbor needs to hear this. Your brother, your sister, your mama, your daddy, your child, your co-worker, the person you go to school with, in the power of the Holy Spirit, those people need to hear. And we don't need to be afraid of telling it. Revelation 12:11 said they love not their lives even unto death. That means he's speaking of people who gave their lives for the sake of the gospel. We have good news to tell. And number 8, those who believe are then swept up in this victory. We are swept up in the victory of Jesus Christ. That means his victory becomes our victory. That means what he won becomes our winning. And so we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory. It is a gift from God. We didn't win it. You didn't win it. I didn't win it. All of us together with all of our power and all of our ingenuity could not win it. Only he. And he didn't step away from death. He stepped into death. And he was willing for your sake and my sake to take the sting of death, that we might say, oh death, where is your sting? Oh grave, where is your victory? But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, Paul speaking to brothers and sisters in Christ, my beloved brothers, using the same word that Jesus used to speak of those who were his followers. My beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Whatever you might, whatever cost you might give and pay for this, whatever price you might pay, that this would be known, that this victory would be known, it is worth it. Why? Because the victory is ours. The battle is the Lord's. And so number 9, and good news of all good news, we can now live the life where we were created to live. And I think about, and I shared this with you a few weeks ago, you know, Adam and Eve, I think maybe the second saddest thing in all the Bible, first saddest thing is the cross. But alongside that, right alongside that, is Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, having been given every provision that they need. Everything they needed was theirs in the Garden of Eden. Everything they could want to eat. And not only that, but the Lord walked with Adam and Eve in the garden. And then we see that moment when they took up, they broke the one commandment God gave. I mean, like one rule. We say, if you just kind of give me fewer rules, I could do it, all right? Well, give me one rule. And what did they do? Broke it. They broke it. And the sad part is what happened after that. That God comes looking for them in the garden. God fully knowing, of course, being God, they have. But God confronting them in the garden. Adam, where are you? And Adam saying, I've hidden myself because I was ashamed. And I was ashamed of what I've done. But what I want you to understand this morning, that if you have given your life to Jesus Christ, if you have responded in faith to Jesus Christ, you have been restored. The restoration simply means that you now, it is possible now for you to live the life that you were created to live. You no longer are under the hold of sin. Does that mean you're going to be a perfect person? No, that's not what we're talking about here. You are perfect in position in Jesus Christ, and you have been given power to stand against sin so that when temptation comes, or when you begin to get afraid and no longer are willing to step forward in obedience in Christ, He stands alongside you. Your mighty warrior has won the battle, and you are able to live the life that you were created to live. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We were created to bring glory to Him, but we've fallen short. But here's the good news. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's not just talking about life in heaven. It's talking about the life that He gives you right now. Eternal life. It's life of a whole different kind. It's a whole new ballgame, folks. No longer are you gripped by sin. No longer must you be under death. But instead, you now can live the life that you were created to live. The Apostle Paul said, we were buried therefore with Him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in what? Newness of life. That's talking about the life that you were created to live, so that you are able to live in moment by moment obedience to God. And the more you obey Him, the more you love Him. And the more you love Him, the more you want to obey Him. And that's what God desires for everyone that's here. That's what we're talking about when we say, let your life be swept up in the victory that accompanies the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, I just need to ask you this morning. First of all, Christian, are you living in this abundant life, this newness of life that God has given to you? Or, I mean, are there other things in your life that have just sort of captured your mind, captured your heart? I would just say to you, listen, you're going to stand before Him one day, and you're going to and there's going to be a reward given. And the reward is going to be based on the life that you've lived. If you're a Christian, you will not be judged for your sin, but you will be judged and rewards will be given. I'm going to tell you, I don't want a little trophy in glory. I don't want a participation trophy. I want to know that I lived. And even if it has to be said that I died for Him. Now, if you've never made that faith response to Jesus Christ this morning, I want you to understand this as well. That if you do not respond in faith in giving your life to Jesus Christ, sin still has grip on you. And death has a grip on you. So that you should be afraid to die. I'm just telling you, you should be afraid to die. Because the wrath of God that was poured out on Jesus Christ will be poured out on you, and what Jesus Christ paid for in 6 hours on the cross, you will pay for eternity unless you give your life to Him. I'm not trying to scare you, I'm just trying to tell you the truth. And so what we would ask you to do today is to turn to Him in faith and respond to Him in faith. All that we talked about here this morning, He promises even more. Why would you not give your life to Jesus today? Today, if you hear Him speaking your name, give your life to Jesus.